Okay, I think we're going to go ahead and get started. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight for this evening's program featuring Professor Chia-Ling Wu, Professor of Sociology at National Taiwan University. My name is Susan Burns, and I am Professor of History here at the University of Chicago, and I'm also the Director of the Center for East Asian Studies. The Center for East Asian Studies at the University of Chicago is very pleased to be cooperating once again with the Taipei Economic and Cultural Office in Chicago, otherwise known as TECO. This collaboration allows us to present lectures that showcase important scholarship about Taiwan. We are grateful to co-sponsor this event with the support from the Taiwan Ministry of Culture and TECO through their dedicated Spotlight Taiwan program. I'd like to welcome everyone this evening, particularly our special guests who are in attendance tonight from TECO's office in Chicago, including Daniel Wong, who is the director of TECO, and John Lin, who is the director of the Education Division. For more information on the University of Chicago's Center for East Asian Studies, please visit our website and subscribe to receive our weekly outreach emails. You can find the links in the chat box. For more information about our co-sponsor, the Taipei Economic and Cultural Office in Chicago, please visit the chat box and find the link there that will take you to their website. Now, following the end of the presentation tonight, we'll have a Q&A session. To ask a question to be addressed during this portion of the program, please be sure to type your question into the Q&A box. Now, I'd like to introduce our distinguished speaker tonight. Professor Chia-Ling Wu has a deep connection to the American Midwest, having received her PhD from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, just a couple of hours from our campus. I met Professor Wu more than 10 years ago at a conference at Hong Kong University, where she gave a really wonderful paper about childbirth in colonial Taiwan. I also work on issues of reproductive health and reproductive rights, and so I've followed her research with great interest ever since that meeting. Professor Wu works on a fascinating array of topics situated at the intersection of science, technology, and medicine, the politics of gender and reproduction. She's also an activist in this area and has co-founded an NGO called the Birth Reform Alliance, which aims to improve reproductive care in Taiwan. Currently, Professor Wu is working on a book entitled Making Multiple Babies, Anticipatory Regimes of Assisted Reproduction, which sounds really fascinating. Her talk tonight is entitled From Single Motherhood to Queer Reproduction, Gender Politics of Assisted Conception in Taiwan. So I will turn things over to Professor Wu now.
Thank you very much, Susan, for your kind introduction. It is my great honor to have this opportunity to share with you my ongoing research projects. I would like to thank first Professor Susan Burns for the kind invitation and the staff of the Center for the East Asian Studies for their assistance to make this talk possible. And part of today's talk is based on the book chapter I wrote, published in Gender, Health, and History in Modern East Asia, where Professor Burns also contributes to one chapter. I translated the English chapter into Chinese, updated some information, and published it in the reader about same-sex intimacy in Taiwan. If you can read Chinese, you can check the book as well. So the gender politics of assisted conception has been evolving in the past 2 years after Taiwan legalized same-sex marriage in 2019. I will touch upon some of the latest developments in today's talk. And I'm still working on this research project, so I would like very much to get your feedback later. So since 1960s, there has been a lot of debates in many parts of the world, including Taiwan, about who can become a parent through assisted reproductive technologies. So the left one is an older assisted reproductive technology, intrauterine insemination. The method is that the sperm is taken out to be washed in a lab and later put into women's uterus during her ovulation period. The sperm can come from the male partner or donors. It has been practiced in Taiwan since the 1950s. The right one is in virtual fertilization. The first test baby in the world was born in the UK in 1978. IVF has been seen as a medical breakthrough. The typical IVF procedure is to retrieve the egg from women's body and often several eggs after some stimulation drug. And the technician will put the egg with the sperm in the lab for fertilization. If successful, the fertilized egg, which called an embryo, will be transferred to the woman's womb and hopefully achieve pregnancy. So these forms of ARTs were first used to treat couples who have problems of infertility. However, since the donor insemination, IVF, and surrogacy all separate procreation from heterosexuality, so ARTs has become an important method to create new possibility to build unconventional parenthood and kinship. For example, the women's movement in the UK, US, and some European countries in the 70s used self-insemination to achieve pregnancy without men. Self-insemination means to collect the sperm from the donors, and then women uses a turkey bastard to insert the sperm into her body by herself. This reflects the feminist desire to seize the means of reproduction. The goal was to fight against patriarchy, heterosexism, and medical professional dominance. You can see some manuals about self-insemination and donor insemination families from that time. Since 1990s, some feminists and lesbian groups have asked the legal inclusion to receive better medical care. Globally, the regulation addressing access to ARTs are moving toward liberalization, and increasing numbers of countries do not restrict its use to married heterosexual couples alone. However, according to the IFS report in 2010, among 62 countries answering the survey, 20 countries still specified married couples as the only eligible treatment group. 14 are Islamic countries and 7 are Asian countries, including Taiwan, Hong Kong, Japan, Philippines, Singapore, Taiwan, and Vietnam. Taiwan has, from the first ethical guidelines in 1986 to the Assisted Reproduction Act in 2007, continued to prohibit unmarried women and men from using ART. However, even though we have the strict regulation, state regulations seem to legitimize the privileges of heterosexual marriage. Since 2000s, the Taiwan LGBT family rights advocacy has openly advocated how to achieve pregnancy through ARTs. So the right one is a 2010 publication titled Building a Family, Childbearing Guidebook for Lesbians, which was the first such book ever to be published in East Asian countries. And the right one is a poster of some gatherings among lesbians to share their experiences about the use of ARTs to achieve pregnancy. So such tension continues after Taiwan legalized same-sex marriage in May 2019. Most international media highlighted that Taiwan was Asia's first country to legalize same-sex marriage. Reuters made this map on the right at that time to present where same-sex marriage was legal in 2019. And you can see the green shade in the North America and some parts of South America and most parts in Europe and in South Africa. And then you have Australia and New Zealand. However, in Asia, there's only this tiny bit of green out over there, and that is Taiwan. So Taiwan's gays and lesbians have been getting married since then. According to the official statistics, over 4,000 couples got married within the first year. Even the military held a wedding ceremony to include two lesbian couples, and BBC and other international media reported the event. My informants, Ivy and Maud, also got married. They took their four kids with them for the marriage registry, and all of the four kids were born through assisted reproductive technology before they got married. However, the right to marriage does not equate with the right to have a family. This is a map about lesbians' access to ARTs, and you can see Taiwan is not listed there. Even today, the assisted reproductive the Assisted Reproduction Act still only allows heterosexual married couples to have access to IVF, donor insemination. So I would like to use the case of Taiwan to analyze the gender politics of the access to ARTs. The intersection of gender, sexuality, and heteronormativity shown here is built upon the past literature. Each cycle indicates a major organizing principle that may guide the perform governance of the access in the society. For example, from the aspect of gender, some may present ideal motherhood and fatherhood in order to include or exclude the use of donor insemination for single women. In addition, some literature highlights the importance of a hierarchy of sexuality in access debates. In some countries, it is the fear of the implication of adultery from third-party donation that leads to the allowing only married couple to use ARTs. Heteronormativity is another important analytical framework. Heteronormativity means the various ways in which heterosexual privilege is woven into the fabric of social life. In the ART policymaking, whether having one father plus one mother is inherently in child's best interest is often the center of the debate. The tension between the conventional statute and the practice of gender outlaw, those who break the gendered orders of institutional norms, remind us to take the so-called techno-scientific governance approach to study the access politics. So I would like to follow the diverse, I think it's important to follow the diverse stakeholders, not only the formal policymakers, to see how discourses and practices of gender, sexuality, heteronormativity, triangulation may change. In addition, we should examine the local moral world rather than simply look at the codified bioethics. Law is important, but law is changing and people do not simply follow the law. So for today's talk, I will share three major research findings. I will start from the single motherhood and then queer reproduction. And then I will move to the transnational reproduction, my latest research project to examine the crossover among the Taiwanese single women gays and lesbians who have to go abroad, and international married couple who come to Taiwan to use the ART. So that's start from the emergence of women who choose to be single mothers in Taiwan. And in introducing donor insemination to Taiwan, doctors were the primary gatekeepers in deciding who could have access. And they assumed married couples were the only legitimate users. Legal experts began to discuss formal regulation of ARTs only after world's first birth of IVF babies born in the UK in 1978. Most Taiwanese legal experts at that time also assumed that ART should be used for the married couples only. And Taiwan's first test baby was born in 1985, which was widely celebrated as a major medical achievement in Taiwan. The couple holding the baby was cutting the cake with the doctors to celebrate the success. You can see the happy picture. And government issued the ethical guidelines the next year, which clearly stated that ART should be used by married couples with infertility problems and prohibited single and widowed people from using it. So I interviewed one advisory committee member about the guideline. He told me that, quote, in 1985, you simply didn't come across movie stars wanting to have kids out of wedlock. By default, we limited the use of ART to married couples. So what movie stars? Before the mid-1980s, single motherhood in Taiwan was either invisible or was portrayed as the tragic result of innocent young women being forced to engage in sex. So the image of voluntary single motherhood started to emerge only in the late 1980s, when several Taiwan and Hong Kong-based celebrities became pregnant without the father's names being revealed, at least for a while. So this paved the way for other single female celebrities going abroad in the 1990s to use the sperm banks to fulfill their reproductive desires. By late 1990s, donor insemination had become more openly available to single women in several Western countries. And so some well-known celebrities in Taiwan, such as Bai Bingbing, revealed frankly to the public that they had gone to the US or Japan for ART treatment. So I call these celebrities moral pioneers, using Rainer Rapp's term, because they challenged the ideas of conventional reproduction and attempted to become single mothers by choice with ARTs. However, they did not translate their action into challenge to official regulations. Therefore, they failed to become moral entrepreneurs who could make radical change. So the first political mobilization for inclusion of unmarried women in the ART regulation came from the Taiwan Society for Reproductive Medicine, TSRM, the leading medical association for infertility experts. They held a press conference in 2001 to promote the inclusion of unmarried women. So in their published report, the Secretary in General, Dr. Zhang, stated that some of the single women were their parents' only breadwinners. Plenty of them are CEOs or active leaders in our society. They were too busy to have an opportunity to find the right man and get married. Should we deprive them of the reproductive rights? So who are these CEOs? So I met a single mother, Xiao Yi, who gave birth to twins through donor insemination in 1985. This was the earliest case I could find of a single woman fulfilling her reproductive needs through donor insemination. And Xiao Yi had once been an activist in Taiwan's democracy and women's rights movement in the late 1970s. She later developed a successful business career at a car company, daring to take an unconventional route. She had wanted to become a mother without getting married when she reached her early 30s. At that time, as I show in this graph, only about 10% of women remained single in their early 30s, but the rate has increased rapidly since then. So this attractive woman, Xiaoyi, thought about getting pregnant through the one-night stand. But according to her, none of her admirers supported the ideas. So she then met a sympathetic doctor who recommended donor insemination, which she had never previously considered. So the doctor arranged a sperm donor and she gave birth to twins. So according to the DSRM report, doctors did gradually meet single women, feminists like Xiaoyi, cohabitating couples, and infertile divorced women in their clinics who requested access to donor insemination. And some doctors followed the 1986 ethical guideline and 1995 regulations not to offer the services. But some doctors were sympathetic to them. According to the survey that DSRM did in 2001, 26 of doctors said that they supported giving unmarried women access to ART. This was still far less than the near 60% of doctors who supported offering surrogacy to married couples in the survey. So I interviewed one opinion leader in TSIM and asked him why the medical society supported the inclusion of single women. And he mobilized the discourse of motherhood as important part of femininity to explain that these capable women deserve to become mothers. And he told me that. He told me that we have met some highly educated, financially self-sufficient women, and these women did not have the chances to get married, and technology can help them. And they are very caring persons and suitable to be a good mother. And most of the time, they were raising cats and planting flowers. Why not help them to raise kids? So this quote often reminds me our current president, Tsai Ing-wen, a single woman raising cats and dogs. This is an image that she put on her Facebook the day after she was elected as president, playing with her cats. Okay, so the medical doctor, TSIM, collaborated with legislator Lai, now our vice president, to support a statute proposal to include single women. So the statement said that based on the equal rights, ART should not be limited to married women. In 1949, the Geneva Convention ensured the protection of reproductive rights, which is not limited to married women. So in other countries, it has often been feminists, rather than medical professionals who have adopted such a position to argue for liberalization of access to ARTs. As I will present soon, feminists in Taiwan have another agenda. So during the debate of over the Assisted Reproduction Act, the so-called Lee case happened. The Lee case in Taiwan is like the Baby M in the US, provoked a huge societal debate on ART regulation. So in year 2005, a Taiwanese Army lieutenant died in a tank accident. His fiancee, Ms. Lee, with the assistance of a high-profile infertility expert, Dr. Lee, asked for posthumous sperm harvesting to undergo artificial insemination, IUI, and bear the lieutenant's child. So the Ministry of Health at first declined the request, claiming that according to the ART regulation, ARTs was restricted to infertility treatment of married couples. However, the media covered the story closely, and it became a national debate. So various numbers of people expressed their diverse opinions, including the vice president at that time, with legislators, bioethics experts, activists, and bloggers. So expression of support were based on diverse and even contrasting discourses. The most prevalent opinion was to sympathize with the woman's tragic love story and support her quest to have her lost fiance's baby. And other supporters also appealed to the discourse of rights for single women to, in order to support Lee. An objection to Lee also came from both traditional family ideology and also progressive feminist discourses. The leading legal expert in ART, Professor Dai from National Taiwan University, stated that the government should not encourage out of wedlock birth by giving single women access to ART. And some argued that it was against the child's best interest because of the lack of a loving father. And some feminists also opposed the idea by arguing that it contributed to the discourse of compulsory motherhood. For example, the legislator, feminist legislator Huang, suggested that it was a patriarchal value to extend the patrilineage through the posthumous insemination. So since 1970s, Taiwan's main feminist agenda was to promote women's right to education, work, and political participation. In the field of reproduction, the agenda was against compulsory motherhood. Women should not be confined to become wives and mothers. So feminists tended to support abortion rights, not to become mothers through the technology, but were ambivalent support ART and surrogacy. So this is quite different from the agenda in Western feminists in 1970s. So feminists in Taiwan have not been active to promote the inclusion of single women during the legal regulation. So in Congress, the legislator, Hou Shui-sen, offered a new image of what modern women's use of donor insemination. So he said during the Congress, the new generation does not regard marriage as important. Our law does not prohibit births out of wedlock. So therefore, if some single women want to raise a child to relieve their work pressure, because as long as they see children who look like some movie stars, they feel happy and fulfilled. How can we reject it? Possibly the whole street of girls would like to have the sperms of Pei Yongjin. Who is Pei Yongjin? Pei Yongjin was a Korean film and TV actor who was tremendously popular in Taiwan at that time. So legislator Ho was presenting an image of crazy fans who might want to become the mothers of his children. Though the scenario was impossible under the guidelines at that time because the donor had to be anonymous, and there could be only one live birth per donor. So however, legislator Ho's words introduced a new image of single women into ART debate, SS debate, not the devoted Miss Lee, but the irrational modern women. So this could bring chaos to the society. So other conservative voices joined to oppose to have babies born without a father. And on the other hand, the TSIM's allies did not persist and feminists did not engage. So eventually the law was passed in year 2007 to confirm again that only married couples are legitimate users of infertility treatment. Occasionally, feminist organizations such as the Awakening Foundation would argue for the inclusion of single women in ART, but again, this was not their main agenda. So instead, it was the lesbian mothers group that took the lead to reform the ART in Taiwan. So I'll move to the next section. Taiwan's gay and lesbian movement had boomed in early 1990s and soon took on a leading role in Asia. And parenthood, however, remained a marginal issue for a while. And in 2005, a number of young student activists from the gay and lesbian rights movement initiated the group and invited lesbian mothers to talk about their experiences. And most of these mothers, according to some recent research by Amy Brenner, she just published this brilliant book, and other research from Taiwan, for example, had children. The lesbian mothers had children from a previous heterosexual marriage. And adoption was possible, but very few. And there were a lot of cases to achieve their pregnancy through assisted reproductive technology. And some achieve it through self-insemination, some through the contractual marriage with gays, and some had to go abroad to use the ARTs. For example, Teresa became the mother by arranging marriage with a gay man. Teresa was a governmental official who joined the Taiwan's first lesbian group, Ourselves, in the mid-1990s. And she and her partner arranged a kind of blind dates with gay couples through the BBS, a kind of online discussion board. And in order to find the gays to arrange the contractual marriage. So under the legal regulation, they need a kind of marriage license in order to get the medical services to use the IUI in the medical center. So gradually, the lesbian community found out that such arrangement often led to an ongoing burden of care within the patriarchal family, including serving the parents-in-law who care for the babies often. And Teresa, for example, got divorced later because she found out that the gay father of her child was often absent from the child care. And some lesbians practice passing as heterosexual singles. These lesbians were able to find sympathetic doctors in private clinics who may violate the regulation to help them to have the access to ARTs. But these lesbians found out that they have to present themselves as single women rather than lesbian couples to avoid some discrimination based on sexual sexual orientation. So cross-border reproductive care has become more visible among lesbians community in Taiwan since early 2010s. Scholars prefer to use the term reproductive exile rather than reproductive tourism to emphasize the constraints that force members of excluded minority to go abroad. And in Taiwan, the so-called tea tree moms are often referred to as the Taiwan's first lesbian couples to have ART abroad. They got married in Canada and gained legal access to use ART there. They share their reproductive journey in details in their blog to help other lesbians better understand the situation. However, going to Canada or the US for ART is hardly affordable for most lesbian couples in Taiwan. So Emily and Stacy, another lesbian couples, offer their detailed information on their Facebook pages. They are very influential to build another new network to have ART abroad. So Emily Stacy had the health checkup in Taiwan. We have very good health insurance, national health insurance, and it we have easy access to the prenatal care, for example. And they got information about ART in the US, but they thought it was too expensive to go there. So they then tried to order sperm from a sperm bank, commercial sperm bank in Denmark. The sperm bank told them that the sperm cannot be shipped to Taiwan due to some trade regulation, but could be sent to the clinics in Thailand. Therefore, they went to Thailand to have the ART procedures. So I call this a kind of global assemblage of reproductive cells, information, regulation, expertise. Due to their pioneering experiences, they help build a new route to achieve pregnancy in Thailand. And the sperm donor was a Royal Guard in Copenhagen. So they asked me to take a picture of the guard exchange when I had a chance to go to Copenhagen for a conference. So Taiwan's lesbian couple started to take another new procedure called A with egg and B giving birth approach in recent years. So A provided the egg and B carried out the pregnancy. This pregnancy is called co-IVF or shared motherhood IVF. In some cases, it's done for the medical reasons, such as A not being able to carry the baby in term and B having problems producing eggs. However, many lesbians who employ this approach in order to build a biological connection with children on part of both parents. So A has the genetic linkage through the egg and the B is the birth mother. They do so because Taiwan's civil law only recognizes the birth mother as a legal parent. So the other partner cannot be the legal parent, both before and after legalization of same-sex marriage. So in the context of Taiwan, as well as many other countries, combining the gestation and genetic is an important strategy to maximize the legal rights of the non-birthing partners. And also prefer IVF to the simple technology donor insemination when going abroad, because IVF has a higher success rate, although donor insemination is less intrusive. So the Lesbian Mother Alliance turned into the Taiwan LGBT Family Rights Advocacy 2 years after, and they share information and strategy among the LGBT community. A gay man also joined them in the later stage and offering their experiences to have surrogacy, mostly in the US, as well as in some other countries. They published manuals to advise on how to consider when they want to have babies. So you can see both the gay couples and lesbian couples in this new manual. And they joined the Pride Parade every year to ask for the legal reform. This is a banner with the phrase about how to procreate for the nation with the old man, who is our national father on the banner. So the declining fertility rate in Taiwan has been a serious issue. And these lesbians argue that, why not give us the reproductive rights so that we can give birth to the babies for Taiwan's better future? And legal reform is an important goal for the activist group. They asked to change the Assisted Reproductive Act. And one couple also who conceived their twin babies in Canada went to court to ask for the right of the parenthood from the non-birthing partners. They had a legal suit in 2015, but it was rejected by the law. So the gay rights to achieve parenthood is more complicated. It requires surrogacy, which has been illegal in Taiwan since we have any regulation. So in year 2012, when a consensus conference, a deliberative method for policymaking on surrogacy was held in Taiwan, some participants already challenged whether only heterosexual married couples could use it. So this showed that feminists and the LGBT movement could at least raise the issue against the privilege of heteronormativity. In recent years, more and more gay fathers went public to share their stories. All of them went to the US for surrogacy, for those cases I showed on the PowerPoint. So the one on the upper left is a gay couple of Taiwanese American and Caucasian American with their son. They often came back from the US to Taiwan to encourage other prospective gay parents. And the bottom left one is a filmmaker. And the right one is Martin. Martin became the first gay president of Taiwan LGBT family advocacy. And so the gay parents became increasingly more visible, like lesbians. And the right one is the podcast from the Taiwan LGBT family advocacy. If you know Chinese, you can find it on website to know more details about their story. So Taiwan LGBT family rights advocacy has been an important part of the same-sex marriage rights movement. The left photo shows how they brought their kids to promote the marriage right for political mobilization. After legalization of same-sex marriage, the married partner of the non-biological mother or non-birthing mother still need to go through the adoption to become a co-parent. So they have been fighting for building a better procedure to gain a legal parenthood status. And they continue to fight for revising the Assisted Reproduction Act. They support for including married lesbians. Currently is the greatest among the policymakers and legal experts, and followed by married gay couples. So the framework of marriage rights becomes a very important guidance for legal revision. Therefore, single women who almost has no activists to represent their voices seem to be left out. So the final part of the talk is about transnational reproduction and gendered bioeconomy. So there has been increasing use of ARTs in Taiwan. The latest statistics show that in 2019, more than 40,000 treatment cycles were performed. It grew about 5 times in 10 years. So it's a big bioeconomy. And among them, about 10% of the cycles use donated sperms and eggs. This showed a very rapid growth, 10 times in 10 years. So who has been using the third-party donation? And the dark blue bars are donated eggs. So the market, the third-party donation grows faster for donated eggs. More than half of the third-party donations are conducted for married couples from abroad. So the main users come from China, Hong Kong, and Japan. Here's the website of Taiwan Fertility Center, located near Taipei 101, which mainly offers the services for people from China, Hong Kong, and Macau. And other clinics offer services for infertile couples from Japan. This is a post from a Taiwanese clinic who had arrange an information sharing meeting in Tokyo to explain how to use the egg donation from Taiwan. So the big words in red, circled with red, means egg. In Japan, the egg donation and the sperm donation have had only limited availability in recent years. So couples went abroad for their reproductive needs, and Taiwan is one of the most popular destinations. So by now, so here is the repro migration map. By now we can tell that while Taiwanese citizens who are excluded by the law need to go abroad to Canada, US, Thailand, Cambodia, and some went to Australia or Russia for surrogacy, and some infertile couple, that's the case for the excluded single women, gay and lesbians had to go abroad. But some infertile couples from China, Hong Kong, and Japan came to Taiwan. Some other Taiwanese Americans, Taiwanese Canadians also come to Taiwan for ARTs. And the network for the users from Philippines and other Southeast Asian countries have been built. So the pattern of repo migration clearly shows that the heterosexual marital status is the foundation to gain access to ARTs in Taiwan. Taiwanese single women, lesbians, and gays for parenthood have to go abroad. Heterosexual married couple from China, Hong Kong, Japan can come to Taiwan for ART, especially for the donated eggs and sperms. So they have the so-called flexible biocitizenship to use ART in Taiwan, simply because they are married. So marital status rather than citizenship rules Taiwan's norm for pursuing parenthood through ARTs. So how transnational reproduction is organized give us some more clues. For example, who has donated the sperms and eggs? They are mostly single women and men in Taiwan. So some single women, according to my colleagues, Huang Yuling's research, they foresee that they may remain single. So they consider donating their eggs to helping others. It's a good act since they won't produce children. They might not be able to produce children in the future. So who are the recipients? Heterosexual married couple with advanced maternal age from Taiwan, or heterosexual married couple from abroad, where the third-party donation is difficult to arrange. Therefore, Taiwan's low fertility rate and increasing singlehood becomes an important ground for single women to provide eggs for infertile couple. The US CIA, I don't know why CIA, but it's the CIA, predicted that Taiwan would have the lowest fertility rate in the world this year, 1.07, followed by South Korea, Singapore, Macau, and Hong Kong. This has become the headline news recently. And Taiwan's current fertility rate is 1.1 child per woman of reproductive age, which is lower than most European countries. And the US is about 1.6 and 7. So singlehood has increased. For women 45 to 49 years old, the rate of never getting married increased from 2% in late 1970s to 17% now. Men's rate is actually higher, but the media usually target women when discussing marriage and reproduction, and then blame single women to be kind of selfish, too much self-sufficient, so that we have such a low fertility rate. So while the mainstream media tend to blame single women for Taiwan's lowest fertility rate, let's see how single women are associated with assisted reproductive technology today. If they prefer to become single women by choice through ARTs, they are excluded by law. So they have to, they do not have the status of biocitizenship, so they need to go abroad. If they may get married late, leading to a delayed parenthood, IVF clinics will promote them to use the social egg freezing to freeze their eggs when they are young. In reality, they seldom have the chance to use their frozen eggs because they need to get married first, and it's not easy to find the right person to get married. And single women who are also approached by the IVF clinics to donate their eggs to help Taiwanese or international infertile couples. So paradoxically, single women are excluded from the ART to become parents, but mobilized to fulfill other people's reproductive goals. So conclusion. So Taiwan continues to restrict the ART eligibility to heterosexual married couples. It seems very hard to break the marriage heterosexuality reproduction association. The reproductive exile of Taiwan's singles, lesbian, and gays, and the cross-border reproductive care from international married couple illustrates how heterosexual marriage status best benefits from the biocitizenship. We need to think whether this is reasonable. The ART network is built based on public money. The medical education, administrative management, and various infrastructure. So why are some citizens excluded while other non-citizens can use it? Moving beyond the legal regulation, gender relationship, as well as the politics of sexuality and heteronormativity are changing in Taiwan. So the efforts come from moral pioneers and gender outlaws have rewritten the user script of ARTs. Before year 2000s, heterosexual single women with high socioeconomic status like CEOs or Ms. Lee won the highest support from the doctors as well as some policymakers. Since the middle 2000s, lesbians who used to be invisible users in the eyes of doctors and policymakers become the system builders to lead the debates over access to ARTs. So activism matters. Taiwan's feminist agenda has been against compulsory motherhood. Therefore, there has been no strong collective action for single mother by choice. I think we need to consider the approach of a pro-maternal feminism that supports women who like to build families through ARTs. And activism from lesbian and gay men have extended the issue of marriage right to family rights. And they have now become the leaders for the Assisted Reproduction Act reform. However, there is some complications. When family rights come after the marriage right, when we tend to support the rights of marriage couples, including lesbian and gay couples, to access to ARTs, do we privilege two-parent married couples as the ideal parenthood and families and discriminate against others? And there are different forms of stratified reproduction here. For the excluded users, they are deprived of biocitizenship, and this is certainly a kind of discrimination. And for those who are forced to go abroad for ARTs, they face more health risks, legal risks, financial burden, and stress compared to those who can use it right in Taiwan, for example. And not all the excluded users can afford going abroad. It requires social capital and economic capital to do it. So the strategy is only doable for a small number of among the people. Single women also faced heightened social stratification in the ART market. They are excluded by the law to use ART to become mothers, but they are advertised to use social freezing. And even though it is usually useless, and they have been mobilized in recent years to donate their eggs, helping the infertile couples to fulfill their reproductive genes and help Taiwan to become the kind of largest egg donation hub in Asia. And even today, there's almost no spokespersons for single women in every hearing about the SS debate. I think we need to recognize the different levels of stratified reproduction when we reform the legal regulation. So the final slide here shows a self-made poster during the gay pride movement. The words say, 祝生娘娘保佑同志多子多生, the goddess of fertility to protect lesbian and gays to have more offspring. I took the photo myself. I think it's really well made and creative, but I hope goddess of fertility can protect single women as well. Okay, so this is today's talk. Thank you very much and for your attention. And I look forward to your comments.
Thank you so much for that fascinating talk. I've got a bunch of questions, but I will hold them and invite our participants to ask a question. You can do it two ways. You can raise your hand using that raise hand function in the bottom of your screen, or if you prefer, you can pose it using the Q&A and I will read it out for you.
See. I saw Martin here. Martin, you want to say something?
Hi, Chia-Ling.
Hi. Did you see your photo here?
Yeah, I saw it. Thank you so much. I don't know if I'm disturbing a very high-level academic exchange here, but I have one question, though. Mm? I think you raise a very complete status of the issue in Taiwan. And considering that gay rights and also birth rights for women, single women, is quite a debate also, like countries such as France try to pass a bioethical law on birth, and actually the legislators do back and forth between giving the rights to single women, but then less for gay couples. So we are touching the surrogacy issue, and we know that in the current debate in Taiwan is also about, are we going to go that step further? What do you think we can learn from the, let's say, foreign experiences? Because even though it's a hot topic here in Taiwan, it's also very new. And I feel we don't have enough knowledge or how to work together, for instance, with the feminist movement, etc. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. I can just answer, right?
Yeah, sure, absolutely.
Yeah, this is Martin. Martin is our former president of Taiwan Gays and Lesbians Family Advocacy.
Oh.
So I'm so happy he's here. And I just showed his photos, right? Did you see the podcast?
Yeah.
Martin raised a very important question. And I think Martin has been paying attention to what's going on in France. However, I would like to clarify that in many countries, the right to use ART came before the marriage right of same-sex couples. For example, UK is a good example. So I think we should look more examples. More legal regulation around the world. When UK has the legal regulation on ART, it didn't specify that like married couple is the requirement. It changed the wording a little bit, but they would like to make sure that the child is born in a loving parent, with loving parents. What kind of parents? It's debatable. So loving parents is the requirement, not like heterosexual marital status. And the legal regulation was made before the same-sex marriage right. So we can see that there has been a lot of usage for donor insemination in single women and lesbian couples. So unfortunately, when we have this assisted reproductive act, we did not have sufficient debates about why, what's the best interest of the children. So I think if we have a good procedure to have a good consulting procedure, for example, like UK would promote people to do before they use the ARTs, then no matter who you are, heterosexually married or gay and lesbian couples or single women, we need to consider what's the purpose to use the technology to form a family. And then this might resolve some issues about the best interest of the kids. So the issue about reproductive rights and family rights can be separate. But in Taiwan, because we have a really strong gay and lesbian movement, so I really admired that part. But I want to be a little bit critical about whether the framework of marriage might lead like single women to be left out. But back to the history, remember, single women that the doctors met in the clinics would often single out as kind of possible users. So how people phrase the ideal or potential user for ART depends really on this kind of political mobilization. So I think my feminist allies should pay more attention to different kinds of reproductive designs and needs of different women so that they can join to the policy debate.
Thank you. So we have a question from one of our participants. This is from Mary Ann Case. And she asked, what effect, if any, does the president's being a single woman have to do, or does it have any kind of place in the single motherhood debate?
Yes, this is a very interesting question. Yeah, our president is a single woman. And I think she represents a kind of devoted, strong woman to education, work, and leadership. Mm-hmm. So we have this map about if you want to fully develop yourself, and marriage and motherhood is not compatible. So this is part of the story why the singlehood increases in Taiwan. So I think our president represents that part. Then that can be problematic. If we have better welfare policies, so marriage, motherhood, and your devotion to lead the country and to lead a company may not be that incompatible. Right, but the mobilization of our president Tsai Ing-wen is my idea, because when I heard the doctors said that, oh, these women are so caring and capable, but they only raise cats. So I thought about our president, but raising cats, to have a family with cats and dog become
I guess I'm one of those crazy women raising cats because I'm sitting here with a cat on my lap.
Yeah, this becomes a new image of family life in Taiwan. So there's a statistics about the new cats in the family and new kids in the family. The cats and dogs are higher than kids. So I think that's great, maybe, for a new kind of intimacy. Still, I want to criticize that. People think that raising kids is so demanding. Mm-hmm. That might rule your ideal life. It's because the policy. Yeah, we don't have enough public childcare, and the working hours have been so long. It's one of the longest in the world. So we need to reform that part in order to support people to achieve different kinds of family life.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So I want to encourage our participants to raise their hands, but I have a couple of questions, if I may, in the interim. I was interested, you know, the rule that you have to be married to have access to ARTs, how strictly is that enforced? I mean, do doctors ask you to see a marriage license? And if you find a sympathetic doctor and he's willing to help you, even though you're not married, does he face any kind of sanctions or punishment for going against that rule?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's very important questions. In Taiwan, to have a law to have a guideline may not work, but to have a law means you have a sanction. So in a procedure, you need to provide a marriage license so that doctors can continue the treatment. Mm-hmm. And it's by law. So that's why it becomes a barrier. According to our interviews, some doctors really do not obey the law, but they are... only a few, because they risk violating the law.
I see.
Their license of practice might have some problems. But on the other hand, that's a problem to have a law. For example, as I showed that some celebrities go to Japan to have donor insemination. So people have the wrong perception that maybe the Japan's law is better. They offer services to single women. This is not the situation. It's because they do not have the law.
Yeah.
They have the medical guidelines to say that it's better to provide the services to the married couple. But after all, it's a guideline. Even though medical doctors in Japan might mostly conform to the guidelines, but there's no law to disobey because there's no law. So the travel around the world really depends on the legal asymmetry. But our legal regulations becomes a very strong barriers. So sometimes it's better not to have, so that you can run by the maybe societal norms and medical guidelines. But once you have a law, to change the law requires so much political mobilization. So it becomes very demanding to change the access politics.
I wanted to pick up on something you just said about this sort of, people's response to reproductive exclusion, where they go abroad for surrogacy or ART. And I wonder, I guess this is probably more pertinent to the surrogacy situation. How does it work in terms of citizenship if a gay couple goes and finds a woman in the United States to have their baby? How does the child born of that surrogacy relationship get citizenship in Taiwan?
Maybe Martin can answer that. Hi, Martin. Better than I. I think they get they have made efforts to make the child citizenship guaranteed. So Martin, you want to explain how a child can get the citizenship you want during the procedures?
Actually, the child is born American.
Mm-hmm.
And if the one of the, I mean, for Taiwanese, I'm Taiwanese, and in the, my son was, is my biological son, not mm-hmm. my partner's. So when we get back to Taiwan, because of the blood relationship, we have to give a DNA test to the administration, and it proves directly that, you know, he's my son, and then the administration will recognize the filiation first, then immigration will recognize his citizenship, and we can go into the local administration to register in the family book. I don't know how to say it in English properly. But
registry.
So that works in this way. My partner being French, we actually under the current law could have our marriage recognized first in Taiwan and applying the adoption procedure for even a foreigner in Taiwan. So that's the second step, adoption. And because of our situation, which is a bit complicated, the judgment, which should be positive, obviously, in Taiwan, has to be recognized by a French court.
Mm-hmm.
And the French court will basically say a kind of equivalence, exequatur, and then we can be registered in France, and my son will get his French passport. But that's still under the lawyer's hands in France for the moment, after 2 years.
Oh, that's very, very complicated. Okay.
So I think this is a kind of legal risk, even though you spend so much energy and money to have your biological child, you still have to go through the all kinds of procedures, and something might go wrong. So, by assisted reproduction act in Taiwan, for anyone who have a contact with the health professionals, you become the parents of the of the child. So I think that's easier.
Mm-hmm. And if I could just ask one more question, this is also about the sort of, you know, global movement of people in search of access to reproductive technologies. I know that in both Japan and South Korea, when people are seeking out donor eggs, for example, or donor sperm, they're quite concerned about ethnicity. So in the West Coast of the United States, you know, you see advertisements in UCLA student newspaper for Japanese American women or girls to donate their eggs. And so I wonder, in the case of Taiwan, do you have that kind of, I mean, do parents, gay and lesbian parents, are they concerned about that, about seeking out, you know, kind of ethnic match, or are they oblivious to that?
I know better about the Japanese couples who come to Taiwan, to answer your questions first. So ethnicity plays a very important role, because they want the child who share the same ethnicity with them. So Taiwan becomes an ideal destiny, even though the donors are not Japanese, but they are Taiwanese.
Yeah.
So some Japanese doctors I interviewed encourage their patients that, our people from Kyushu is very close to Taiwan, so they look similar, so feel comfortable to go to Taiwan. So I think it's part of colonial history.
Yeah,
that bring us together.
That is so interesting.
Right, but at least for lesbian couples who might, for example, Emily and Stacy, who ordered the commercial sperm bank from Denmark, I think they have two ways. One even prefer the Caucasian white, because like the mixed blood child has some kind of attraction in Taiwan. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. So they don't, and since they are lesbian couples, so they have to tell their children that they come from the third party donation. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't have to hide the procedure. For some Japanese couples, married couples, they use the same ethnicity so that they can conceal the and it's and we have the donors have to be anonymous, so they don't have to tell the third party donation stories behind the birth. But for the lesbian couple case, it's not an issue, and mixed blood babies have some attraction, but also some people prefer to have the donors from Asians. So it's either way.
I see.
But I think the regional travel is so important because we only know part of the story. For example, the Japanese couples come to Taiwan, and in order to increase the success rate, they might be implanted with more embryos. So they become pregnant with twins, which has a higher health risk.
Yes.
So they go back to Japan. Japanese doctors might complain that then we have to take care of the highly complicated, high risky pregnancy. So we cannot have like a standardized procedure to lower the risky pregnancy. Because each country has its own regulation within the nation state boundary. But when people traveled, we have to think about how to regulate the procedures together.
Yes.
So that's why the regional travel has raised some new issues. Mm-hmm. So even though when we have been fighting for the revising of our act, but we can, it's hard to work together with policymakers from Japan or South Korea. But European countries have been doing that. They have kind of surveys in order to figure out, to have a complete map about how people travel and for what reasons, but so that they can produce better regulations to all the countries to follow.
Mm-hmm. I see. Let me see. Do we have any hands up? We're getting close to the end of our time, so please take this opportunity to ask a question. This is so fascinating to me. I don't see any hands. Well, I will raise my hand again. Could I ask one more question? And this has to do with the finances in this sort of global movement of people in search of access to reproductive technologies. I guess I'm just wondering, obviously it's more expensive to go overseas. But I wonder, in the case of those who do have access in Taiwan, how expensive is it? In the US, most insurance policies won't cover ARTs. And so it is it's very expensive. And so even though there's no legal barrier, the high expense is a way in which access becomes stratified. So I wonder, in Taiwan itself, is it covered by the national health insurance policies?
Yeah, no, thank you for asking the questions. This is very important. So it has not been covered by national health insurance, and there's no subsidy of ARTs. So for each treatment cycle, it's about $3,000 to $4,000. So it's more affordable here than that in the US.
Yeah.
However, after the UA CIA reported the lowest fertility rate in Taiwan for this year, the government felt pressure to offer some new services. So they initiated a very generous subsidy program to ART, to boost infertility rate. So this become a new issue because it's out of the public money. Again, you need to be married couples to use the ARD. I think
that should be the basis of a lawsuit, that people's
exactly.
tax money.
Yeah. Right. So each couple at least can have one free, I think six free IVF cycles in their mm-hmm. lifetime before they give birth to one baby. So again, single women, lesbian couples are excluded from the public financing. So I think this should be a very important issue. Many lesbians complain to me that they pay tax to the government.
Absolutely.
They are obedient to citizens, but they are not only excluded from the law, but also from the public financing program.
Yeah, no, that's...
You think that should be a one?
I think
important
that
point?
Should be some. Somebody should take that and go to court.
Okay.
My expert legal advice.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much. This has been such a fascinating talk. I've learned so much. Let me sort of go to our sort of ending here. I want to thank everyone for participating in this evening. I hope that, like me, you've enjoyed it and learned a lot about a really pressing set of contemporary issues. We'll be hosting, the Center for East Asian Studies will be hosting its third and final Spotlight on Taiwan lecture next month on November 18th at 7 p.m. Central Time. Please join us as we welcome Assistant Professor in the School of Medicine of National Chung Kung University, Yuling Huang, who will be discussing crisis knowledge and politics, Taiwan's COVID responses, which also will be, I think, a very interesting talk. Yeah. For more information on her talk and to register, please click on the link in the chat box. Tonight's program, as well as the first Spotlight on Taiwan lecture that took place on Tuesday, October 26, featuring Professor Xiao Chen Hu from Academica Sinica, will be available for public viewing on our CEAS YouTube channel. Yes, we have a YouTube channel. If you are interested in receiving information on other events and to learn about the resources that UChicago Center for East Asian Studies offers, please be sure to subscribe to our newsletter. So I want to thank our wonderful speaker one more time, and I want to thank all of you for your attendance and participation this evening. Good night and enjoy the rest of your evening. I have to say, good day to Professor Wu, since she got up very early to speak with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.